Thanks very much. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Thanks to all of you who've joined us around the world. I'm Jeremy Zucker. I'm a partner at Dechert and the co-head of our international trade and government regulation practice. Delighted to be joined today by five other speakers. Delighted that we're co-presenting this presentation together with the Brunswick Group. And our speakers include Neal Wolin, who is the CEO of the Brunswick Group based in Washington, D.C., Philippe Blanchard, who's the managing partner of the Brunswick Group's Brussels office, based in Brussels, Sir Jonathan Faull, who's chair of Brunswick's European Public Affairs Group, also in the Brussels office, as well as two of my partners, Mark Thierfelder, who's chair of Dechert's Corporate and Securities Group, based in our New York office, and Alec Burnside of our antitrust practice, jointly based in Brussels and in London. The six of us are delighted to be with you today. We'll be speaking about foreign direct investment controls in Europe, in the United States, and around the world. As was mentioned, we're aiming for this program to last 1 hour. We certainly don't intend to speak that entire time. We would welcome your questions. Please send them in through the chat function, and we will take them at the end, as many as we can. And without further ado, I'll hand it over to Alec and Sir Jonathan to talk about developments in the European Union.
Jeremy, thank you. I'm Alec Burnside. Very glad that you've been able to join us in such good number. Europe has a new system, equivalent, if you like, to CFIUS in the States, which is, of course, familiar, but it's not quite CFIUS. CFIUS is a centralized notification system. What Europe has created for itself is a coordination system with the European Commission sitting in the middle and helping member states, advising member states who have their own systems of review. That's presently, as you see in the graphic, about half of the 27 countries in the European Union, which have foreign direct investment reviews of different types, uncoordinated, certainly, as we'll be mentioning as we go forward. The introduction of European regulation predates the pandemic. It was a part of a trend driven particularly, I think it can fairly be said, by Chinese outward investment, but it's taken a whole different dimension since the pandemic, with concerns spreading about opportunistic acquisition of companies while they are an undervalue, and in particular with assets such as healthcare assets coming into this important national security category in a way that was not so before. At a very high level, that's the new European regulation. It's adopted, but not yet in force, due to come into force in October. Jonathan, tell us something more about the state of play with the regulation.
Well, during this period in which we are waiting for it to come into full application, individual governments have been busy. And of course, events have been very largely overtaken by the COVID-19 pandemic, which has, if anything, strengthened so far the view in Europe that foreign direct investment is needed, but also needs to be reviewed thoroughly. As you say, Alec, at the moment, that is done at the level of each individual country with some coordination taking place centrally from the European Union headquarters in Brussels. One of the interesting things to look out for as we emerge from this crisis is how stable that system is and whether there will be, as I rather think will happen, a push for a further bout of centralization and the creation of a European system which will look a lot more like the American CFIUS than it does today.
Yes, yes, indeed. We have a regulation on foreign direct investment, but the question is, what's foreign, what's direct, what's an investment? The regulation does not set out to define that. It simply talks about screening mechanisms that member states may have, and screening can take many different forms. Investment isn't defined as such. There are no higher or lower thresholds at which acquisition of an interest is subject to review at the European level. It's just any system which does that. And there's the question of what the arrangements are in question. The regulation counsels against artificial arrangements to circumvent the FDI controls. What is an artificial arrangement? If you have a European company of long-standing good heritage, which at some point 10 or 20 years ago was purchased by a non-European, and that company makes acquisitions, is that an artificial arrangement? I guess you would think not. If you set up a holding company, a new vehicle to make an acquisition, is that artificial? Well, it's usual commercial practice, but it might be seen as sort of a circumvention. The European Commission is meant to be coordinating all of this. That sounds like a challenge. Jonathan, some thoughts on that?
Well, there are all sorts of rather vague definitions which will have to be worked out in practice. The Commission is beginning already before the entry into full force of the regulation to issue guidance. I expect there will be more communications and guidelines from the European Commission. And as the system begins to be put into practice, there will be cases, there will be litigation, there will be a practice which is developed, and we will learn more about it. In answer to your questions, and I think they are the pertinent ones, in FDI, who's foreign, what's direct, and what's an investment, they at the moment will vary in the eye of the beholder. Practice will solidify. Who is foreign is a very interesting question. Who is foreign and what foreigners are you most worried about? In the 1960s and 70s, I think most Europeans would have said the United States of America. 10, 20 years ago, they would have said Japan. Today, they will say China. And we have a very interesting new development. How foreign is the United Kingdom for the European Union, and vice versa for that matter? So foreignness and whose foreign investment is welcomed and whose is worried about is an important issue. It is never very much on the surface because everybody will always say we don't discriminate. We look at each case on its merits, but nobody can deny either that politics and international relations have a bearing on it.
And Jeremy, if you take us kindly to our next slide, there's a set of considerations here we've represented in this jigsaw puzzle, because the regulation does not occupy a blank canvas. There's a whole legal order at the European Union with different principles which play in this area. As you see, we've represented freedom of establishment. We've represented the common commercial policy, the merger regulation, which allows certain legitimate interests to be taken into account by way of interfering with the European Commission's competition review. And then here comes the new regulation, represented as this curious round piece of jigsaw piece, which has to fit in with these other principles. At the risk of overgeneralization, it can be said that the European Commission, over all these years, over 50 years, has played the role of facilitating cross-border investment, looking towards integration of the national economies, trying to make sure that member states do not impede cross-border investment unless they have good reason. And now, in a body swerve, the European Commission may be the coordinator of that interference. Can the interference be extended to cross-border within the European Union? The Spanish extension to its rules recently adopted does that. There is some interesting jostling ahead as these different legal principles try to accommodate the new regulation. And not least the interaction with competition policy. Jonathan, maybe you'd like to take up that question.
Yes. Well, I mean, I think the basic starting principle, just to pick up what you said about who's foreign, has to be, and the European Commission will push very hard in this direction, that within the European Union and greater Europe beyond it, so those European countries not in the EU, but tied by treaty arrangements into the European single market, they are not foreign to each other. And the fundamental principles of freedom to invest and to establish and to move around will be enforced. There will be rows about it, of course, as there always are, but foreign for the European Union means outside the European Union, or at least outside the European Union and the countries closely associated with it. Competition policy also plays a very important role in this because, in particular, in respect of mergers, when a would-be acquirer of assets or a company in Europe is foreign, then bedrock principle no discrimination, fundamental reality is that there is ever greater scrutiny of the situation of the foreign acquirer under competition policy as well as under foreign direct investment policy. There is concern about whether the foreign acquirer has advantages brought about by subsidies received back at home, wherever that may be. And there is concern about whether a reciprocal situation would be allowed to arise. In other words, would a European company be allowed to acquire a company in the foreign acquirer's home territory if the situation were reversed? These are not new issues. They have been kept under the surface for a long time, but they're now very close to the surface and indeed beginning to erupt.
Well, indeed, lots of issues ahead. As I say, the regulation properly is only going to enter into force in October. But if I just take us back the slide by way of introducing the people at the European Commission who are going to be in charge of it from then, this is trade rather than competition. So it's Phil Hogan, the commissioner nominated from Ireland, trade commissioner, and not Margrethe Vestager, the competition commissioner, although she indeed has been out on the stump recently talking about an instrument on foreign subsidy, which sort of occupies the same space. In any event, it is a decision, it's a role, the opinions that the European Commission will give for the whole College of Commissioners. So DG Trade, in the same way as DG Competition, advances a dossier, comes up with a draft, but the opinions that the European Commission may send to member states are adopted on behalf of the whole College of Commissioners, whom you see pictured there. Of course, the role of the European Commission is to have a dialogue with the member states, with the governments, with the reviewing authorities, and not directly with the companies. The companies are undergoing national procedures and will interact with whichever ministry or authority deals with the national procedures. In the real world, of course, the people at DG Trade are here in town. Jonathan, how do you see the likely interaction with the European Commission in its new role and the scope for companies to have dialogue directly at that level?
Well, there will be opportunities, there will be discussions, there will have to be procedural arrangements set up so that the parties can make some input into the process. But you're right, it's a government-to-government process. That's the way it's been set up. It's not like the merger side of competition law in Europe, where there is direct engagement between the authorities and the private parties. It's much more like the state aid side of the European competition policy, where the engagement is between governments and the European Commission about the role that they play in the marketplace. So that procedural side of things will also have to settle down once the regulation comes into play, and companies will have to take advice and seek opportunities to make their views known in a process affecting them, or indeed affecting one of their competitors. This can be a sword as well as a shield, of course.
Well, uncharted waters ahead, lots of challenges. We shall see how well it functions. It may, as we hinted earlier, prove to be a staging post towards a more centralized system, but that's to be seen. So much, Jeremy, from Europe. Back to you.
Thanks very much, Alec. Thank you, Jonathan. Now I'll have a chat with Neal about developments in the United States. Of course, we welcome questions at any time. Please don't forget to send them in through the chat function. We'll get to them. Neal, as we think about the developments in the European Union, it's useful for us all to bear in mind that the United States government has been screening foreign direct investment for decades through CFIUS. And also, at least in recent years, we've been pressing allied countries to implement just the sort of CFIUS equivalent screening that the EU is now, some would say, finally getting around to. But at the same time, we haven't been standing still in the United States either. There have been developments with respect to CFIUS, a growing perception in recent years that additional types and kinds of foreign investment present national security concerns and also should be reviewed. As a result, back in 2018, a new law was passed to expand CFIUS's jurisdiction, referred to as FIRMA. And over the 18 months or so since that time, we've had a rolling suite of regulations come out. I think at this point, we're just about done with regulations giving full effect to FIRMA. From your time as a senior government official, Neal, can you speak to the climate in which FIRMA arose and maybe talk about differences, to the extent there are any, in the viewpoints of the Obama and Trump administrations with respect to screening foreign investment?
Thank you, Jeremy, and thanks for including us in this webinar. I think FIRMA is best understood to be the result of a set of factors that had been building for some time, many of them. For one thing, there's been a longstanding bilateral conversation, I would say, set of complexities from the United States perspective about whether intellectual property rights are protected with respect to American technology by China in particular, but other governments, other private parties as well. I think a lot of the FIRMA conversation, a lot of the things that built up to create FIRMA were, although the statute doesn't mention it explicitly, around U.S.-Chinese complexity and tensions, partly over intellectual property, partly over cyber and other things. I think it's also the case that from the U.S. perspective, and this is for administrations that are both Democratic and Republican reaching back, that increasingly China has been seen as the technology competitor. If you look at China 2025, for example, the idea that China wants to compete with the U.S. On technologies that include important technologies that have national security relevance has been something that's been noticed and creates some amount of anxiety in Washington, D.C. And finally, I think if you look at the CFIUS docket, as recently as 2012-13, there were very few inward Chinese transactions involving a Chinese acquirer. But that started building meaningfully in the latter half of the Obama presidency and obviously beyond. And those things together, I think, created the circumstances in which the U.S. Congress believed that there needed to be a broader, tougher regime in place, largely to deal with Chinese acquisitions, and in particular, Chinese acquisitions involving sensitive technology or infrastructure or data. And as you note, it's been a bipartisan effort. There aren't very many things presently in America that can be characterized as bipartisan, but China-related questions are one of those. And so I think the right way to think about these developments is that they're largely evolutionary and they largely show up in the context of U.S.-China bilateral questions.
Hmm. Well, you know, before FIRMA, CFIUS jurisdiction was viewed as being almost entirely in the province of reviewing foreign acquisitions of control over U.S. businesses. And now thanks to FIRMA, CFIUS also has jurisdiction to review non-control levels of investment if the target company is associated with so-called critical technology or critical infrastructure or sensitive personal data. I think. I was going to say, I think it's important to think about what's meant by control in that context. There was a U.S. Supreme Court case from a few decades ago having to do with obscenity in films, and a justice of the Supreme Court said that his test for obscenity was he knows it when he sees it. And I think for many of us who practice in front of CFIUS, it would appear that CFIUS takes the same view with respect to control and their ability to exercise their discretion to decide that a transaction is something they want to review is only enhanced now that they have the authority to review transactions below the level of control in certain circumstances as well. I know we have a number of folks from the private equity community on the line today, so I want to race to mention that there is a PE exception built into FIRMA for non-US investors who are investing through a US fund. There are a number of conditions that need to be satisfied, but they basically boil down to ensuring that the foreign investor is passive, it can't control the fund through which it's investing, and it doesn't have access and won't have access to the sensitive non-public technical data of the investment target. There are also new rules governing the review requirements with respect to investments made by sovereigns. And in fact, there was just an amendment to that aspect of FIRMA a few days ago. We published something on it yesterday. Happy to take questions on that later in the program as well. Stepping away from some of those details, Neal, how should foreign investors think about the political context in which CFIUS does its job?
Well, you know, I think that CFIUS itself, by which I mean the career staff that look at these transactions and make judgments about national security risk in the intelligence community and amongst the CFIUS member agencies, are themselves largely insulated from political considerations. They've served in administrations run by Democrats and by Republicans, and largely are focused on the technical aspects of these deals. They sit, however, amidst agencies that are led by appointees of the president and senior executive branch officials who are themselves not as well insulated from politics. And I think, at least for the moment, in particular with respect to inbound Chinese transactions, there's a lot of focus and a lot of politics around those kinds of deals. And so inevitably, the work of the committee gets shaped by that broader political context, and ultimately decisions are made by cabinet level officials or senior officials in each of these CFIUS agencies who, as I say, live in a fairly political world. And I would say over time and in more recent years, the willingness of the White House, for example, to be engaged in and involved in these kinds of conversations and ultimately the judgments reached by the committee has increased. And so in particular on China deals, there's been this I would call it a political overhang or context which has meaning, needs to be taken account of by parties to transactions and thought through very carefully. I think it means, you know, thinking about mitigation strategies. It means thinking early on about how to deal with the kinds of concerns related to the potential acquisition of sensitive technologies by governments, including China, but perhaps some others. And so I think it's sort of slightly more political, slightly more in need of taking account of these broader circumstances in American public policy and political life.
Let's pivot now, Neal, to a brief discussion of how COVID-19 impacts the way the U.S. government thinks about foreign investment, what the implications are for CFIUS. I mean, I think first and foremost, we would expect to see heightened scrutiny now for investments in areas of the economy that wouldn't traditionally have been thought of as posing national security risks, like pharma, healthcare, PPE, and supply chain issues more generally. We're certainly seeing other countries ramp up their foreign direct investment screening that haven't had them before. And then other countries that already had CFIUS-like mechanisms that are further enhancing those mechanisms. And we're seeing this in Australia, India, the UAE, in addition to the EU developments that Alec and Jonathan were discussing a few minutes ago. And clearly that's driven by concerns that foreign investors, perhaps we can just come out and say Chinese investors, will scoop up assets at distressed valuations. In the US, we've also seen the Defense Department promoting what they're calling a trusted capital marketplace to allow companies in the US defense industrial base to access what, according to the DoD, is considered clean capital and to crowd out what they consider adversarial investors. What's your view, Neal, on how CFIUS may change its evaluation of national security risk, especially when we have distressed assets involved?
So I think all the points you make, Jeremy, are exactly right. There's always been a little bit of ambiguity about what constitutes national security. Questions about whether, for example, national security is food security or health security and so forth. And I think in the current moment, as you suggest, there's been an increased sense that in the US certainly, that we need to pay attention to our own capacity to have the right medical equipment, the right pharmaceuticals, the right things across the spectrum really that allow us to take care of our own needs. And so there's been a kind of a heightened sense of protectionism. And I think this is true, as you say, in the context of pharma, healthcare, broader supply chain questions. I think also the COVID issue has taken a decidedly sort of bilateral cast with, you know, U.S. politicians pointing the finger at China in ways that are beyond national security or CFIUS, but will have its spillover effects. And I think there's no question but that this will bleed into the CFIUS process. There will be, with respect to distressed assets, with respect to things that the U.S. feels like it needs to have onshore in moments of crisis like the current moment, an increased skepticism of allowing foreign acquirers to take control over things that might in certain circumstances be unavailable to the U.S. and therefore want to be husbanded. So I think there will be a kind of a higher level of scrutiny, whether it's on the things you talk about or even things like we've seen on semiconductors or other kinds of critical technology that are important to the industrial base or the technological sort of supremacy, if I could say it that way, because I think that is largely how it's viewed by the government. And so the trend lines that were already present, I think, are likely to be both intensified and broadened in the wake of the COVID circumstance.
You know, there's so much we could continue to talk about, but with an eye on the clock, I'm going to ask you just one other question, and I'll encourage our participants to send additional questions in through the chat function. Neal, I'll just end by asking you how our foreign investor clients should think about political stakeholders in the CFIUS process and should think about planning for their participation, however direct or indirect, in CFIUS determinations. Mm-hmm.
So I think there's two levels at which, Jeremy, foreign acquirers should be paying attention to this broader political environment. One, as I say, the CFIUS process is not sort of conducted in a hermetically sealed box. They are, you know, buffeted about and to some extent affected by broader geopolitical or even domestic political circumstances. And I think that, you know, that means thinking early on about what those issues are and how they might be mitigated, as I said earlier. I think there's a broader set of considerations as well, which have to do with reputation. And, you know, for European acquirers or for others who aren't necessarily based in the US, getting caught in between the US and China is a complicated proposition. And so trying to make sure that one thinks about the broader set of stakeholders in these transactions, thought leaders, politicians, the media, their own supply chains, their own business partners is important so that they don't get sort of reputationally hurt in the context of trying to navigate what has become a very tricky process in getting your transaction approved from a regulatory perspective.
Thanks, Neal. I guess I'll close by saying, notwithstanding the complicated politics of the moment, both at Dechert and at Brunswick, we're continuing to see a lot of activity, a lot of investment, and continuing to help those investments make it through the CFIUS process. And for more on what we might call details from the trenches, I'll pass over now to Philippe and to Mark.
Thank you, Jeremy. as a practicing M&A and private equity lawyer, I do want to just point out for the audience that notwithstanding Jeremy's topical elucidation of the Supreme Court test for obscenity, control is still not, in my book, a four-letter or obscene word. So, Philippe, with that, let's turn it over to you. Tell me what you're seeing today in the trenches in Europe. You know, face it, Brunswick, interacting with many clients, many acquisition transactions, sitting in Brussels. What's happening in the trenches in Europe from an M&A perspective with FDI?
Thank you, Mark. I think the first thing I would like to pick up is the point that Jonathan made early on, is that obviously we've got a very fractured market and fractured regimes for the moment in Europe. So it's difficult to give you an overall picture as we have 14 member states with a regime in place, 13 without a regime in place, and obviously very different rules depending on the state. What we did here is just prepare a little bit of statistics or data on what we've seen recently in three key markets, two of the EU and one which is recently become a third country to the EU, but obviously a very close country and a country with a tradition of sovereign control on certain economic assets. But let's start with Germany. We can see there's quite a large number of transactions being reviewed, and about more than a third of these transactions being reviewed are being reviewed because we have Chinese acquirer, potential Chinese acquirer. So the concern around China are very much there. The number of case reviewed do not ever effectively lead to prohibition. A little bit similarly to the US, what we're seeing is that buyers are putting their form together and application together, are engaging in dialogue with government, and if they feel they are getting stuck, either are encouraged to withdraw their application, or effectively governments are organizing white knights. And we've seen that on a regular occasion and recently in Germany, for example. In France, the same thing can be said. Very, very few transactions have been prohibited so far. What we're seeing is a lot of remediation being pushed forward at the suggestions of government. And they include suspension of investors' voting rights. They can be prohibition and limitation to distribution. Supply agreement, I think we will see much more of that, where certain member states will want to have control on supply chain rather than effectively control on a company. And they will want to make sure to have access to certain commodity products, particularly in the food and healthcare sector. In the UK, much less so far. A lot of it has been really focused on media, interestingly enough. And I think one of the biggest cases we've seen recently was the Sky Fox deal. But obviously, there's a growing feeling more needs to be done in all these markets. I mean, in the UK, some of you may have seen this week the chair of the Foreign Affairs Committee of the House calling for a new regime to be put in place in the UK, very similar to the rest of the European Union. And we can see the UK wants to be at least in line with the Union, probably wants to have leverage in engaging with the Union if the Union was to treat it as a really aggressive third party on its acquisition. France and Germany are also moving their rules at the moment. We talked about control. The rules in these markets are not focused on control, they just focus on the level of participation. And the review was triggered traditionally with a level of participation at 33.3%, which is effectively control in French law. Now we've dropped to 10%, and that's the case for Germany and France for a whole set of industries. The traditional suspects of utilities plus defense plus technology, which have now been extended with food and healthcare. So that's the main trend we're seeing. The last one I wanted to come back to is a point Alex raised earlier on, is that we're seeing much more so new tools being developed, and this antitrust tool that could be developed by DG Comp to measure the level of subsidies received by a buyer in the context of an M&A will be an interesting tool because there will be a low coordinated approach. And I finally also suspect that what we'll see is, you know, buyers themselves will encourage more and more the adoption of an overall European regime as they are confronted by this fragmentation of rules, which make it relatively haphazard sometimes to get into a deal. Are you seeing similar pattern on your side, market in the US?
Thank you, Philippe. You know, look, I think important to set the context from what we're seeing in the US is just the, you know, overall decline in the M&A market on a global basis. The cross-border M&A market's been down 16%. Lowest opening level for the first quarter since 2013. The U.S. for U.S. targets from a volume basis is down even more dramatically. The decline year over year has been 50% just for the top 10 global deals that were announced during the first quarter were U.S. target deals, and that brought the overall worldwide share of U.S. deal making to 35%. Down from 52% of overall M&A a year ago, and the lowest percentage since 2012. This is all data from Refinitiv's latest study. You know, against that backdrop, you know, we are still seeing in the U.S. Cross-border M&A activity, and certainly lots of deals being discussed, even during the, you know, deepening severity of the COVID-19 pandemic. Jeremy and our team have been in front of CFIUS many times in recent months. And I think, you know, consistent with seeing elsewhere in the world, deals are taking longer to get through, but they are still getting through. And deals that we might have thought about as being simple from an approval process in prior years seem to be getting an increasingly harder look than previously. And that includes more questions coming from CFIUS for the parties that are involved, and a higher likelihood that we would not just see the transactions go through the review phase, but also potentially into the investigation phase. And then, you know, as you might expect, a higher incidence of remedies being imposed as a condition of clearance of a transaction. Including restrictions on foreign investor access to sensitive non-public tech data of the target, commitments to maintain sensitive target data within the United States, and commitments to have U.S. citizens hold the sensitive positions at a particular target.
And one thing I wanted to ask you, Mark, we've talked a lot about FDI from the perspective of buyers, effectively, and buyers being confronted with the process. But what has been your experience in advising sellers who are considering selling assets in the U.S. to foreign investors? What sort of preparation do they need to do?
Look, I think, you know, as the data that we're seeing from the CFIUS approval process and the lengthening of time, you know, increasing focus when you first engage with a potential seller of a target around how you want to think about who your universe of buyers are, whether or not they will have any particular issues given their country of origin, or otherwise under the CFIUS regime, making sure that sellers think about the correlation and relationship between potentially finding the best fit as for a buyer for a particular target, where the highest amount of value can be achieved, but also how that correlates with speed and particularly certainty of closing, you know, and really trying to have a seller get a good sense of that before they go out in the market, before bankers reach out to a particular universe of buyers. You know, is both a few things that are happening at the same time, but as the time periods for approval and the lengthening of the process for CFIUS approval increases, and at the same time we're living through relatively, you know, unprecedented times in terms of what the impact of the pandemic is having on business operations around the world, you know, you're faced with a situation where your period to get to a closing date may be increasing at the same time that a business may have, that's a business that's being sold, may have extra pressure around its operating covenants and what it can and cannot do during the period of time that it's under a signed contract. So as the complexity in the world deepens on a bunch of different operational and regulatory levels, I think it's very important for sellers to be focused on that early and to revisit that often in each stage of a transaction process, including as they're negotiating final documents to execute a trade. Philippe, I know you've had some a lot of experience with sellers. Maybe tell me a little bit about some particular interaction you've had related to British Steel.
Well, on the buying side, and British Steel was one example of that, what we're seeing is obviously a need for a lot of transparency and engagement on the side of the buyers, particularly when they are not necessarily known entity. I mean, obviously, there are some, we were talking about control earlier on, very known actors in China or in the Middle East, which do not require a lot of research in order to put together the information needed for the authorities to take the decision. But we are seeing more and more people coming into deals which do not have profile, we do not have any form of digital profile, we do not have any profile on governance, we do not know who are the individuals controlling this business. And the first thing an intelligence officer is going to do for checking this information is effectively going to go online and look at what they can find and the history of that information. So if the digital history is not present and if you do not have clear transparency, you do have a substantial problem. And preferably, you would want that information to be readily available in English or in the language of the country of the target as much as possible. And sometimes that can be quite a big job, particularly when people are coming late to that realization. I think the second point in our experience has been the need to think through the fragmentation of the market, anticipate that there may be issue in different markets, that people may challenge supply chain issue, and that may lead to the fragmentation, by the way, of the target you're trying to acquire. So in the case you recently mentioned, we've seen a Chinese bidder trying to acquire an asset, a depressed asset in the UK with the blessing of the British government in the steel sector, and the British government actually providing state aid for the purpose of that resolution. But nobody had thought that the French government would come up and say that they had an issue with the supply of rail track to the French SNCF, which is, you know, probably one of the biggest symbol of French economy. And eventually that review led for the time being to a stalling of the sale on the French side of the property. So yeah, they realized part of the sale, but not the entirety of the sale. So you cannot think I'm just going to go where control is actually happening or where the government has oversight of control, but you need to look through jurisdiction. I think we will see more and more of that. The last point I wanted to make is that, as Neal alluded to, you have a process, it's well defined, you've got a number of agencies being involved, should be in Germany, should be in France, in Italy, or in any of these markets. But you can't ignore the local reality and the local political reality. When you do deals like that, and particularly when you go after relatively distressed assets, the local politicians will pay a lot of attention and local politicians will feed back into this process. And they will feed back, first they will be fed information by trade unions, they will then feed back to central government as to what they think of the acquisition. And it's relatively easy for a government to decide what is national security and what is not. So we talked about the definition of control, but for me, the biggest difficulty we have at the moment is defining what is national security. And it can be a rather movable feast at the moment in Europe.
All right. And so just quickly, before we turn it back over to Jeremy for questions, a lot of people are drawing parallels for the state of the global economy, the M&A market, to the financial crisis that kicked off in 2008. But in many ways, this is much different, right? That was a crisis of liquidity. Here, there's less of a liquidity crisis, and in fact, governments are taking a lot of actions with respect. How do you see the relationship between the next 5 to 6 months of the global M&A market, the stressed assets becoming available due to the pandemic, and the high amounts of state-funded liquidity that are going to be available and sloshing around the markets?
Yeah, you are absolutely right. I think when we talk to investors coming from third country and tell them about the FDI rule getting more and more stringent, the type of response we tend to get is, well, guys, you should remember 2010, and then you're going to call for us because you'll need investors for these depressed assets. The reality, is that we've got about 2.5 trillion euros going around the market of public money. Some of it in loans, some of it in liquidity, some of it in bank guarantees, some of it in actual grants. We've got new rules that allow governments to take equity, and they're doing it at the moment into large companies. So we've seen it in the obvious sectors, aviation, we've seen it in the car industry, so the Lufthansa case or the Renault case very recently. But I would certainly not exclude that as a solution or as a remedy to a threat that cannot be controlled by FDI control, you will see government turning into white knight. To put things in perspective, the German government has currently a credit line of 100 billion euro available for direct equity investment in businesses. That's quite a bit of cash to come to the rescue if they consider a deal to be problematic. So it'd be interesting to see how that one plays out. Yeah.
Well, that's great. Jeremy, why don't we kick it back over to you and Neal for any questions coming off the chat function?
I think Alec will host us on that.
Indeed. Thank you. We've more questions certainly than we're going to be able to deal with, and we'll come back to you individually after the event. Let me pick some questions where there would be both European and American perspectives. When we say foreign, are we talking about foreign state-owned or just foreign? And will a foreign state-owned company necessarily be considered an arm of the state? Maybe first US team and then Jonathan, help us with that notion.
Well, on the U.S. side, foreign means foreign in the broadest sense. There are additional special considerations for foreign entities that are considered to be owned or controlled by their own governments. But you certainly need not be owned or controlled by a state entity to be considered foreign for purposes of CFIUS jurisdiction. And I would say the vast majority of the transactions on which we work involve entities that are private, whether they're operating entities, funds, etc. It's often an interesting and challenging feature of a transaction to tease out the element of state influence or control. Certainly at a high level, foreignness does not require government participation.
Same in Europe.
Yes, well, that's concise. With some controversy on the merger regulation as to whether the arm of state reaches into state-owned companies. So it's been examined particularly in relation to state-owned enterprises in China, how far they need to be clubbed together, simply in making the competition assessment. Some far-reaching views, I think, in some CFIUS cases about the extent of Chinese influence over Chinese companies said not to be state-owned. Certainly that's one area of controversy. And then a question that probably fits for those in our last discussion. How far ahead do you need to get going in your preparations for all of this? And then how long do you need to build into your deal timetables? Let's ask Philippe first about Europe and Mark from the US.
I mean, I think it's a little bit like in antitrust. I would recommend building a due diligence process in when you're investigating the deal. So are you going to do it or not? What is the environment in which you're going to do the deal and review the political environment in which you're going to do so? Really map out properly the jurisdiction in which you're going to be confronted with, understand the stakeholders from the national to the local level, and make sure you've got that very clear picture and the risk assessment being done before you actually jump in. Obviously, we've all been in a situation where you get on the deal and deals are done very, very quickly because the chairman wants to do something very quickly. So that can be done quickly, but the more time, the better. That gives you a little bit more granularity in preparation. And that allows you, I suppose, a little bit, same as we do in antitrust, to be ready to have very specific communication ready to address the needs that are likely to arise.
Yeah. I mean, in the antitrust world, to butt in, simply merger reviews in complex cases from the time they're announced, we've seen them run even a year and a half until clearance. We have statistics on that we issue. But Mark, please go ahead.
Thank you. I think from a U.S. perspective, very similar to what Philippe said. I mean, very important to understand the asset that you're bringing to market, understand the global footprint of that asset, and understand where, and this is obviously changing very rapidly as new FDI regimes get either enacted or expanded, even over the course of the past few weeks. But think about it not just from the CFIUS perspective, but from a global multidimensional jurisdictional perspective. Also think about the fact that in the U.S., besides CFIUS, we have very many industry-specific regulations about foreign ownership and the amount of foreign ownership that a specific asset in a regulated industry can have. And getting in front of that early and then really trying to understand who your buyers are, very important to also educate the board of your seller because as they're entertaining offers that are coming in, you know, the headline price may not be the only relevant thing that the board needs to consider. Just like in an antitrust context, you need to understand the ability to get a particular buyer to closing and how what the risk is and how you allocate that risk. Not every purchase price may have the same exact value when you look at certainty of close. But I would be, and often am, when we've got global buyers looking at an asset, one of the very first things that we're doing is interacting with Jeremy and Alec to understand where we could have issues and how to get the board of the seller smart about thinking about embarking on that transaction.
Is anyone would like to add? Neal, I see you nodding vigorously.
Yeah, I mean, one I think thing early on, because as colleagues have articulated, it's often important thinking through how to structure a deal or how to organize it in a way that might ultimately lead to more mitigation opportunity that will be sought in the CFIUS process or in other regulatory contexts on a sectoral basis, as Mark suggests. So I think thinking about these things right from the beginning, it used to be the case that we would see lots of deals sort of almost completely baked, and then someone at the end say, oh, what do we do now about CFIUS? And I think increasingly it's clear that having this as an element of the consideration with a full suite of advisors from the very beginning of the contemplation of the transaction is hugely important because, as Mark says, these are things that are often very relevant to sort of the economics of a transaction.
Right. And of course, we've been assuming implicitly in what we've been saying that you need your security clearance before you close. that can be different country by country. And equally, there is the possibility of investigations being launched after the event and closed deals being broken up. I think the acquisition of Grindr is a good example. I don't believe anyone anticipated that the issue in that case, which was personal information held on that dating website, would be a security issue. But after the event, CFIUS objected to that information being accessible to a Chinese owner, and through it, it was feared, I guess, to the Chinese state. So that's also a good thing to look after in deal documentation, perhaps, if that's a risk that can be allocated, or maybe it just falls on the purchaser. Mark, if you have a thought on that?
Sorry, Al, can you, I didn't hear, like, the phone cut out. Could you repeat the question quickly?
If there, CFIUS or another security review comes along after closing, it was not a condition to closing, but after closing, there's a breakup. I guess in the absence of a contractual clause, the risk is just on the purchaser, but there may always be a question how you deal with that risk if it's foreseen potentially in advance.
Yeah, look, I think that just puts, I don't think anyone ever wants to face that situation about the potential unwinding or destruction of a transaction, which I think just puts pressure on the analysis that you do up front,
right.
Both from, you know, whether or not you file, even if a filing's not required, and how the parties are thinking about allocating risk, and how much, if any, risk you want to take on a post-closing basis, even when a filing may not be required.
All right, friends, we're on the hour, and it's only good manners to release you promptly. Thank you for your attention. Do follow up with us. We'll follow up with you. We at Dechert, and I'm sure Brunswick too, have published on this. We put out a paper only a week or so ago. You've likely had access to it through the invitation, but be in touch if you need a copy or if you'd like to discuss. We thank you. Jeremy, anything on your side?
Thanks to you all for your participation. Looking forward to working with you.